Hey there, you may think this is just an external drive enclosure. Wrong, it is an actual PC. And if you watch closely, don't you think it looks like a shrink down version of the IBM PC AT? For me, that's reason enough to throw a closer look at it.
Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories.
I start with a confession. I can't really tell you much about this machine and its actual origins. It just looks like a shrink down version of the IBM AT, although it's definitely not an IBM machine. On the front face, it's labeled as an Expert 286, while on the back side, we have this sticker with a logo and the Expert system designation. Apart from this information, that was made in Taiwan. I couldn't find any information whatsoever about this machine or its manufacturer. Although, when looking at it more closely later on, I'm tempted to say that this was most likely an industrial computer. What we see here in a close-up is the actual surface finish, which is similar in style to the one here found on the original IBM PC cases of that era. The color hue is very close, and as mentioned before, the case definitely resembles a shrinked version of the IBM PC AT's case, which is why it caught my attention in the first place. And the brief test reveals it's actually still running. The CMOS battery is dead, but it's still going and comes with some 12 megabytes of RAM. That's not too bad, actually. So let's open it up, shall we? As opposed to the real IBM PC AT, this machine obviously uses a backplane into which a CPU board is plugged. This is typical for industrial computers as it allows for easy upgrading simply by swapping out the CPU board. Upon removal, I realize that this also happened with this machine, as it clearly doesn't sport a 286 CPU anymore, but a 486SX. So it was actually upgraded at some point. This CPU board was obviously made by the CUBIX Corporation in the 1992 or 1993 period. Now, if you like me, never have heard of CUBIX, then that's probably fine. Their website still exists at cubix.com, and my guess that they were and still are into industrial computer designs was totally right. While I didn't find anything on their current website, I eventually got hold of historic information via the Internet Archive, where I actually found information about this board as well, which actually bears the BC4030 designation. This will become handy later on. During my investigation, I eventually came across this website as well, where someone was explaining on yet another historic machine, including multiple of these CPU boards at once. After all, pulling this board reminded me that I had a similar one around, just by a different vendor. To this day, I haven't investigated into this one, but it's from around the same period, just using the standard ISA connector type. To my best knowledge, standard ISA cards would work in an extended ISA slot, but not the other way around. So for me, having no extended ISA backplane available, there's currently no way for me to test this second card. But its time will come, for sure. One issue I had observed already was the internal wiring, such as the power and the hard drive LEDs, which were not connected to that CPU board. Luckily, I found the original connection diagrams for this board on the archived CUBIX webpage, so I could match it up for rewiring it properly in a later step. I found everything but no connector for the PC speaker. But before assembly, I first have to remove everything, as I really want to give the case a thorough cleaning. I had a hard time removing the floppy drive, as you can see here. It's really not like I forgot to loosen up a screw or something, it was totally stuck, and even with applying WD-40, it gave me a lot of resistance. Eventually, I had it removed, so I could also remove the rails. And even when trying to slide them in without the drive attached, they would be stuck immediately. I then took some quick measurements on the rails that came on the hard drive caddy, giving me a dimension of 15.8 millimeters. And guess what? The ones on the floppy drive gave me a 16.1 millimeters reading. Now, that explains everything. So I simply cut away a few millimeters, which should fix that problem. And so it does. After removing the backplane, I'd also pull out the backside control board with these two switches. And eventually, everything's pulled out and ready for cleaning. The plane was mounted to some plastic studs, however, they were brittle. I'm about to remove them so I can replace them with new ones.
What's the holdup?
When I tried reconnecting the power plug to the backplane, I realized the plug being 2 pins wider than the socket on the board. And of course, I didn't take notice of that before, so I haven't documented it.
May I comment on that?
No. Rather let me run through my recordings and photos so far, if I happen to be lucky and can see how it was connected before. Eventually, I was lucky and found the shot I needed, showing me that the connector was center plugged with the two outermost pins left unconnected. So I added some labels for future reference, just in case. I intend to install a CF card as a bootable drive, and I also got some ISA network cards to install. But before, I quickly try something and swap the 486SX25 CPU. Unfortunately, I don't have a 486DX250 at hand, only a 486DX266, which is designated to run on a 33MHz bus clock. The CPU board doesn't provide any means of changing the bus clock, but the DX266 should be fine with the 25MHz clock and run at 50MHz instead. And the system seems to be booting up fine, except that it complains about the external cache not being present. But nevertheless, Norton's system information now reports a 486DX running at 50 MHz. And maybe I can max out the memory as well. According to my reading, this system should be able to support up to 64 MB of RAM. Turned out that I didn't have enough memory modules, but at least I could bump it up to 32 MB. As the DX2 may run hot, I'm adding a cooler to prevent overheating. This is important, as this case is quite dense and there is no chassis fan. I'm then up for the rewiring. The documentation I found earlier now shows its use. For this control panel, I'd remove the second knob as it's broken. I'm not sure what it was used for before, maybe for the turbo button. But as there's no means to connect it, I'll remove it. I'm pretty sure neither of the two are factory original anyway. Let's see if it works. Alright, probably the first time in decades this knob is connected again. Now, since the headers on the CPU board provide only one single ground connector, I had to create a multiplex connector, so I could wire up not only the reset switch to it, but also the ground wires for both the power and the hard drive LEDs. After everything's properly connected, I add this spiral wrap around the wires. I hate loose cables. Eventually, all cabling is properly done, so I can plug the Ethernet card. As I didn't have all the original locking brackets, I had to improvise them a bit to lock the drive sleds. As you can see here, besides the CF adapter, which is mounted to a backside slot, I also fitted a removable hard drive tray, which will hold the real hard drive. Though once inserted, I noticed that the front faces of the floppy drive and the hard drive tray do not align properly. I'm sorry, but I need to do something about this, as it's really ugly. I then essentially created some new rails, which were some 5mm longer. This way, the floppy drive would protrude a bit further and thus align with the hard drive caddy. And once I had the cover applied, I noticed that the front lines would now even align with the top and bottom front lines.
So you're saying this is pure coincidence?
Yes, as I didn't have this one on site. I aligned the floppy to the hard drive front face. I didn't pay attention to the case front lines up until this moment. It's pure luck it came to be like that. Actually, I was more worried about this problem here. You see how the hard drive connector elevates too much, so the case wouldn't slide over it. So I had to replace the IDE cable with a different one in order for the case to be closed.
And this concludes my venture into the Expert 286. Well, sort of. It was upgraded before getting into my possession with that 486 CPU card, and I couldn't find anything about the original manufacturer. What a pity, because it would have been nice to have this with the original CPU card. Still, the newer 486 card gave me some challenges to get the details, though at least here I eventually succeeded. And now, with the system in working condition again, let's see which operating system to install. What would you think about Windows NT 3.1 or maybe Novell NetWare? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story. Thanks for watching and see you next time.
If you check out this channel's community tab, you'll find some polls on potential upcoming videos. You're very welcome to upvote on upcoming topics or drop in new ones you'd like me to chase down.